Happy Valentine's Day, especially to those of you who are single, staying home watching YouTube videos. This one is especially for you. For everyone else, good Monday morning. Well, we're back with another PNSO. It's a surprise for me, as I was expecting another model. But who can complain when you have something as awesome as this sculpt? This is Lu Xiong, the Zhuchengtyrannus. Nice that it has a Chinese name, just like Chuanzi, the Tarbosaurus, revealing its Asian origins. Lu Xiong, by the way, was a general in the Chinese novel Feng Shen Yan Yi. It's about 31 centimeters or 12.2 inches long. Zhuchengtyrannus was described by Dr. David Hone and estimated to be from 10 to 12 meters, 33 to 39 feet. So 1 to 35 scale represents an 11 meter or 35.8 foot long individual. So it scales very nicely with the T-Rex and the Tarbosaurus. The generic name means tyrant from Zhucheng, which is a city in Shandong, China. The species name Magnus means great in Latin, such as in the adductor magnus, foramen magnum, and ultra magnus. Dr. Hone himself isn't too fond of names based on places, and channeling his inner Shakespeare and borrowing from Twelfth Night, he says of Zhuchengtyrannus that some are born with bad names, some achieve bad names, and some have bad names thrust upon them. Now, first impression in terms of overall color. Compared to the release image, you do expect some difference. But this is one of those times that, for me at least, that it's a pleasant surprise. I like soothing colors like earth tones, but we've got too much brown from PNSO already. So greens are more welcome. There are also hues of brown, yellow and gold. One thing I do wish was retained was the black in the back and tail as we see in the dorsal view. Now, PNSO seems to have an idée fixe with dark stripes on lighter skin, but happily, they've changed it up here. This time, the stripes are confined to the tail. Now, let's take a closer look. But before that, just a quick word on the dinosaur itself. I know that many people have been looking forward to Zhuchengtyrannus, but to be honest, I wasn't too enthusiastic because I'm not a fan of models based on the sparsest remains. In this case, we have a near-complete right maxilla and a left dentary bone, and that's it. It's nothing to do with doubts about validity. The experts can identify and use unique features in a single bone to differentiate between genera, and even name a new one, though there's debate on whether they should, even if they could. I trust the professionals know what they're doing.
Who am I to judge?
But while I'm excited from a science perspective, I'm not so much from a model collector's, because first, as you can imagine, these diagnostic features could not possibly be seen in the external form of the animal. And second, even though tyrannosaurids might share the same general bowel plan, just two bones can't tell you enough about subtle differences of proportion that we know of in, say, Tarbosaurus versus the Spletosaurus, or Tarbosaurus versus T-Rex. Now that said, let's get to the model. Starting at the head, there's really nothing to comment on in terms of anatomical accuracy. The general shape of the head. The features like the bosses and other keratinous structures are much as we've seen in other tyrannosaurids, with proportions closer to T-Rex than to Tarbosaurus. I really do like these crests here. The jaw articulates. In the mouth, you have the usual detail in the palate. And also the pseudo cheek. The teeth have some paint overruns. Now, other than this though, the detail in the face is always beyond reproach. Moving down the body, look at that detail. It follows the degree of fineness we first saw in PNSO's tyrannosaurids with Chuanzi. but at times it looks to my eye to be even more improved, if that was possible. I also really like the colour. You can see that the hues are very soothing to look at, with hues of brown, yellow, gold. And sufficiently different from the other tyrannosaurids, even with the stripes, which are very nicely blended. Unfortunately, the forelimbs are really carelessly painted, especially the claws, where you can see some overrun into the fingers, so much so I can't tell if it's deliberate. Just look at that detail. Always impressive detail from PNSO. What a credit to tyrannosaurid representation once again. And all those fine creases and wrinkles. Nice muscular bundle. Even the bundles of soft tissue on the plantar surface. The pose is interesting, and that's what I hope when you have various genera from the same dinosaur group, for example as we saw in the Titan. Frozen in a dynamic moment, as if testing the ground, or in the midst of backpedaling. The daintiness of this step juxtaposed with the bulk of this bruiser makes for a really interesting visual. Amazingly, it balances. As always with all of PNSO's pteropods, you must use the stand for safety against knocks and warping. Now here's the poster that came with the model. Again, very pleasing to look at. Now, some of the science before ending with some comparisons. Believe me, you'll want to see those. How do we decide on the uniqueness of an animal from a single bone? There are a few ways, but relevant to Dr. Hone's paper, the first is identifying unique characteristics no other animal has. The second is to find unique combinations of features. For example, dinosaur A has this feature, dinosaur B has that feature, but only dinosaur C has both. Now first, the usual disclaimer. I'm not a paleontologist. I don't even play one on TV. So if I make a mistake, please comment and I'll be sure to add any errata in my description box below. And also for reference, I'll be using Tyrannosaurus and Tarbosaurus skulls. With respect to Zhuchengtyrannus, we have the maxilla and the dentary. The diagnostic features are found on the maxilla. This part here is the ascending process, and this part here forms the anterior margin of the maxillary fenestra. So, first, the two unique features. One, on the lateral surface of the ascending process, there's a horizontal shelf. Two, in the anterior margin of the maxillary fenestra, there's this rounded notch. Next, the combination of characters. And here, we need a bit of explanation of terminology. I'm going to use this skull of Tyrannosaurus vatar, now considered Tarbosaurus, from Dr. Thomas Carr's article, which I'll link to below. The entorbital fenestra refers generally to this opening here. Entorbital, as you might guess, means anterior to the orbit, which houses the eyeball. However, this can be more specifically divided into the internal and the external entorbital fenestrae. The internal is what binds this aperture. Think of it like the inner edges of this cutout. You also have an outer edge to it, the external entorbital fenestra. Now let me show you on this T-Rex skull. The internal and the external entorbital fenestra. Now between the two edges, there's this smooth excavated surface. Now this inset surface is called the entorbital fossa. This is the ventral part, and this the anterior part. So let's get to that unique combination. First, this is the ventral margin of the entorbital fenestra. And this here is the ventral rim of the entorbital fossa. Now in Zhuchengtyrannus, this part lies well above this compared to other tyrannosaurids. You can see that here in T-Rex, there's almost no distance to talk about because they form almost a horizontal plane of the fossa. Now that's one character, but it's not enough. It must be combined with another. This is the front to back length of the maxillary fenestra. This is the anterior margin of the entorbital fenestra. And this is the anterior margin of the entorbital fossa. And this is the distance between them. Halve this length, and you find that in Zhuchengtyrannus, this is longer than this. Now you can see that different genera have different ratios. And in the Spetosaurus and Tyrannosaurus, these are quite large too, which is why you need a combination of characters. Now an obvious question is, could Zhuchengtyrannus be Tarbosaurus? According to Dr. David Hone, there are a couple of differences. First, Tarbosaurus has a tall ridge here which extends upwards from the ventral margin of the entorbital fenestra, called the subcutaneous flange. Zhuchengtyrannus does not. Second, in a structure called the palatal shelf, in many tyrannosaurids, the posterior part bulges downwards to cover the roots of the teeth. You can see this most obviously in T-Rex, but also in Albertosaurus and to a lesser extent, Tarbosaurus. In Zhuchengtyrannus, this part is suggested to be relatively straight, and I say suggested because the posterior part was not complete. I should note there are a few yet undescribed tyrannosaurid fossils in the Zhuchengtyrannus Dinosaur Museum, some of which might conceivably belong to Zhuchengtyrannus as well. Again, if I've made any mistakes, you real experts, please correct me and I'll update in the description box below with the necessary errata. Now, let's get to the comparisons. First of all, has to be the other Asian tyrannosaurid, Tarbosaurus. And you can see that the scale follows the same improved aesthetic, being very fine, with delicate veins and folds. Most obviously, the peaking here and the belly are gone, which I anticipate will be very welcome for many. The reconstruction of the skull here follows more closely the T-Rex. And speaking of which, we have good old Wilson T-Rex. You'll notice, of course, the improved skin integument. And also the relatively longer legs here. I do think that paint-wise, we hit our all-time highs with the Wilson T-Rex. For example, you see the roof of the mouth. The scales on the oral margin. and the pseudo cheeks. Now, size-wise, Zhuchengtyrannus has been suggested to be larger than Tarbosaurus, but smaller than T-Rex. And you can see that here. What a nice set these three make. And just for completion, here is Andrea, which brings up an interesting idea. If you can overlook certain differences, for example, the leg proportions, you might like to use this as a male T-Rex stand-in. As you can see, the compatibility with Andrea in terms of aesthetics are definitely there. One last thing you might like to see is Zhuchengtyrannus with the contemporaneous Sinoceratops, which is about 1 to 37, so not exactly in scale. But how exact are these scales anyway? The wonderful thing is, all of them scale well to 1 to 35. Now, PNSO has really continued to flesh out yet another group of dinosaurs, and I have hopes for more morphologically distinct ones, such as Despetosaurus, in Teratophonius, or an Albertosaurine like Albertosaurus or Gorgosaurus. The other thing I'd like to see from PNSO is a Tyrannosaurid model without the limits of an articulated jaw, and what Zhao Chuang Shifu can do without this constraint. So, that's it for the Zhuchengtyrannus. This is a long-awaited genus for some of you, and I think you can see that as far as execution, PNSO has continued to deliver, with some minor paint flaws, which, if you can do a minor touch-up, you should bring it up to par. The scale detail is much improved, and you can use it as your male T-Rex. Of course, let me predict that with that fineness taken care of, some people will now be unhappy that he has no lips. Well, let the comments fly. I'll see you soon with another video.